Also, there's a blood drive here on Friday. If you want to be involved, you can call Julie or Bonnie Moody is in charge of it. I just want to put in a sales pitch for the Housatonic Robotics team. They're in a competition now in Worcester. It's their first one of the year. It goes for 3 days. If you want to see, probably Friday would be the best time to watch it on TV. First website usually carries it, and they try to shotgun all the teams in competition. This year, the robot has to pick up a gym ball about this big round, throw it through a target. They've practiced, so it works, and they're planning to move into this building when their season is over in May. So we're working on that as well. There's an open house in Falls Village on the 22nd. That's a Saturday, 9 o'clock. The new tech and art company in there, downtown Falls Village. I've spoken to him, and he's been very positive about working with some of our students here. He's got a nice setup, his name is Bill Arlosky. They've been in Canaan for several years working out of their homes. His wife does the artwork, he does the computer. He says he'll fix your computer. If it's a person like me and you can't handle Windows 8, you can go in and talk to him and get some information that way. So he's very interested in working with the school and our students and our teachers. I've been speaking with Sam Herrick's wife. She said, if we don't mind, if you guys are okay with it, she'd like to make a presentation after our April 9th on the 16th. Now, that's vacation week, so we probably won't have a lot of students here, but I think her topic lends itself toward adults anyway. Her title is Body Energy, and she talks about massage and pathways. I think she's going to talk, we may even bring in some mats. I think she's going to talk about acupressure and those kinds of ways. She's got a shop in the middle of Sheffield, so she's not a rookie. And Sam asked me a couple of weeks ago if that was interesting, so I had a great interview with her, even though I have no authority to do that. And she said she'd be glad to come down, or she'll wait until the fall. Ian has already said we could do Fall Fridays and mornings, do one each month, if we were so inclined. And some of the night people, I know Gail has already said she'd be glad to come down and do her presentation again for students. So we'll run in-house field trips to get gangs of kids, probably over here. So that's another thing in the works as far as it goes. Those are my announcements. I better get to work on my topic. I'll start with my biography. Some of you know that I have a geology degree from UConn a few years ago. And when I was a senior and deciding I probably need to work for a living, I realized the offers I had in geology were not at all suitable to me. I could go into asbestos mines in Quebec. That was one job offer. I could also work actually dodging longhorn cattle poop and rattlesnakes in Texas and West Texas, following some of the surface activities. And there was a possibility of working in a truck in Saudi Arabia, which has had those small charges, those small dynamite charges, and then they would read the waves coming back to figure out where the oil was. I think it was predicted to be 157 degrees in the truck. So I gave that all up and I went to Hartford and worked in insurance. But the good thing about my lousy job in Hartford was this lady also worked there, and so we soon became married.
We did.
And she and two friends said, you've had some speaking experience, why don't you become a teacher? So I went and fought with Central Connecticut to get certified. That's another story I won't bother to tell you. Ed Kirby hired me, and it was soon thereafter he and I taught geology to our students here in Greek course that used this environment as well as our classroom. So that got me going. I've never looked back. I've never regretted it, and I'm still here. And I don't know if that's good or bad, but talking about petroleum and also coal, they're both products of nature. They're carbon-based. Here's a chunk of bituminous coal. If I squeeze it hard enough, I can turn it into graphite and write with it. If I squeeze that hard enough, I can make a diamond out of it. I have to work out a little bit more to get that strength. But in this case, the point I'm making about carbon and hydrocarbons in my talk tonight is that carbon is incredible stuff. And if you remember chemistry fondly, here's a molecular model of CH4. One carbon, four hydrogens, that's methane. It's everywhere, living things especially. So we have coal, peat, those substances from dead plants, buried plants, reconstituted plants. And then most of the geologists think that petroleum comes from little mini sea critters, billions of them that died over the years and eventually were buried in certain sediments that were conducive to trapping their bodies, which became either pools of oil, like this crude. I'll pass these around to you later, but there's some crude oil. It's one step above asphalt, which is the lowest of the crudes, because it hasn't been in a situation where it's too miscible. It doesn't move much. Kevin Whitney wouldn't let me rip a chunk out of the driveway to bring in and show him, but I don't understand. But the great thing about this carbon situation is carbon not only combines with four of these, that's ideal, that's one thing, but also it combines with itself. So there are all kinds of strings of carbon, and this color stands for sulfur, this color stands for oxygen, this color stands for nitrogen, and it just goes on into strings. I don't have enough of these to hook together to show you some of the incredible combinations of the carbon molecules in all directions. If I was to try and come in and make a model of DNA, for instance, it would cover the whole floor, and I'll tell you about this hop. So it is just incredible stuff on our planet, and the fact that when the little critters die off, they can be retrieved for the petroleum products. Whether they're in a shale like this that I got in Colorado, and I'll pass these around, or a sandstone like this that came from Utah, these, surprisingly enough, these heavy-duty rocks are porous. So the oil gets into the spaces in between the other crystals, and it finds a home, it finds a place to adjust to the climatic conditions, whatever the amount of water happens to be. And all of this is hooked into natural gas as well. Methane is a gas, ideally. So I just read in the paper not too long ago that Governor Malloy wants us to barter for the fracking waste that's being piled up because North Dakota and South Dakota are running out of places to bury it. And he's offering, I don't think it's going to sell, but he's offering containers here in Connecticut. They'll ship it to us and they'll fill up these containers, and then we'll get some kind of deal on natural gas prices or supplies as a trade-off. I know that happened in South Carolina because they took everybody's nuclear waste and buried it in their swamps. You may remember the great nuclear waste hassle for Kent, Connecticut in the 70s. They were going to build containers along the edge of the golf course in Kent and also in Sharon. It was going to be pretty extensive. And they were going to truck all Connecticut's nuclear waste. Most of it was medical. And bury it in a pit. And what finally stopped them was the fact that the local swamp was declared an endangered turtle species region. But they never thought of the hassle. The stuff was coming up from Groton and London on trucks. They may have been too tall for the underpasses. There was an awful lot of thought that did not go into the procedure. But there's some oil in rock. Nobody wants to be reminded of chemistry class, right? So I won't pass these around. Here's a little bit of crude. If you want to do more than look at it or sniff it, get it on your fingers. I've got some napkins over here, some paper towels. So on the hierarchy of things, when they fracture, which is different than fracking, when they fracture petroleum, they put it in a giant container. It looks like a double-sized silo. And they heat up and they boil the bottom layer of it. And every 77 degrees Fahrenheit, a different material comes out of the petroleum, which they run off, if you're familiar with the New Jersey refineries. And they run. They run it into different tanks and different segments, and it starts with crude, and then the hierarchy really, as far as fuels go, the fuel oil is next, then kerosene, then the gasolines from diesel to regular to aviation, and right up the list. I think there's 10 steps in that process. And that's one of John D. Rockefeller's specialties, because he was, Dave and I read the same book, but he was a Cleveland waterfront marketing specialist when he was 20 years old. And he was self-taught, incredible mathematician. So he could look at a load of some kind of grain, figure out how much it was going to sell in Europe, and have his companies make money. And so he was doing very well as a young man, but his father had a starring role in The Wizard of Oz. His father had two families, one in Canada and one in upstate New York. They didn't know about each other. And his father, William, also took oil out of the streams, put it in little containers, mixed in a little whiskey, and sold it as a cure-all for anything. You could drink it, you could spread it out in your body. If you had psoriasis, if you had muscle aches, he traveled around upstate New York and across the border in Canada, and just had little towns. You know, it was kind of like Houdini going into a little town and putting on a show. And I always think of the man who actually turned out to be the wizard in The Wizard of Oz, and salesman he was, and he was doing the same kind of things out of the back of the wagon. So William got around, he knew a lot of people, he had a lot of strange deals, and every once in a while, as John D. got more and more successful, he would call him in to help sell some products. So John D. Rockefeller went to, where do you think our first site of oil production in the U.S.
Pennsylvania.
Western Pennsylvania, before Texas, before California. If you want to have some fun, you can go to the replica out at the end of Route 6 in Titusville or Oil City. They're both close to each other. Probably not too far from Meadville. Fairly 80 or 90 miles away from Pittsburgh, but the oil was oozing up out of the ground. And so the Native Americans, the Senecas, were using it for their home remedies. So Rockefeller bought a valley and formed the Seneca refinery company because he wanted to make kerosene. He knew that soon, in the early 1900s, it would be harder and harder to get whale oil for our lamps. And so he knew kerosene was the way to go. So a lot of his early wealth came from refineries. No drilling, you know, he had other people do that. No capturing the materials. He just built the refineries for them. And of course, that eventually became Standard Oil and got so big and so bizarre that he was buying leases of oil in Texas. And when they couldn't build the refineries for him there fast enough, he built a pipeline to New Jersey. He was friends with Mr. Pullman, so he had a lot of railroad activities working as well, and it just became so huge that the government got worried about it being too much of a monopoly. I don't think they did anything about it until probably the 1950s when it was too late, but it was a tremendous business, and it was just based on this goo coming up out of the ground, primarily in northwestern Pennsylvania, but right across the line, there was a lot of it in Ohio, too, along the border, and it was just there for the taking. And you could actually, from what I've read, you could scoop it out of the streams. You could scoop it out of the ponds. It wasn't as devastating, I think, as the asphalt in California that became the La Brea tar pits. That stuff was pretty solid. And the problem was when it rained and water ponded on top of it, the poor critters would come out to get a drink and get caught, and they'd end up trapped in the asphaltic petroleum. If you go there now, I've read that you can go to the La Brea Museum in downtown LA, and they have cut a stairway into the pretty solid tar, and you can see the bones sticking out of the wall as you walk down the stairways. And one skeleton is a woman. And they thought for quite a while that they had discovered a cave woman, so to speak, in quotes. But it was a lady fell in there in about 1905. They have found some humans as well as saber-toothed cats and sloths and the critters you read about. Well preserved, but also permeated by the crude oil as well. So, here are some more samples for you to check out. These are labeled alphabetically, so in order of importance. This is fuel oil. Then the next one is processed fuel oil, which is a lot less clean than any of the other fuels. Then we get into, this is methanol rather. They're all going to smell like you expect, like oil. A little bit of sulfur, depending on how impure they are, if you want to pass those around. Those are the fuel products we're used to from this stuff. I'm not going to talk about the medicines, and I'm not going to talk about the many things. One of the low, easily fractured out of this crude, by the paraffins. So there's all kinds of waxes, all kinds of materials at the bottom of the scale. And up near the top of the scale, it might surprise you, are the aromatics. They're the ones that smell like vanilla. They're the ones that smell like pineapples. They're the ones that smell like oranges. And different companies will take these out of these giant silos and process them, and that's long before they take the base product and turn it into plastics. So these are, as you would guess, samples of plastics. Some of them are cuter than others. This is got a button on the bottom. These, of course, I couldn't speak without talking about Legos. and they are processed. They are made in various molds. Some of them will take certain colors, some of them will not. The trouble with recycling this, and I'm glad Gail's not here tonight because she'll get all upset that I'm saying plastics are good. But if you're going to recycle this, it's a much lengthier process because you got to get rid of the paint as well. That was one of the first problems they had with recycling newspapers. They had to find out how to get rid of the ink. And of course, if you've done any recycling research, there are different amounts of plastics in different numbers, depending on how you can recycle them. The ones you do, you can get rid of pretty easily when you take them to the landfill because they'll just sell them off. The 3s, 4s, and 5s have these other paints, problems, toxins in them as well. So it's an ongoing complex problem. But I think this is a great time you were talking about this when Gail was here. It's time for us to start thinking about processing. Tom Schindler and I are going to a company in Massachusetts that makes those machines in the supermarkets that slice up the plastic bottles, and we're going to see what they do with them after they slice them up. Can they melt and reuse? I know the story, the good story about McDonald's hot packs. You used to get a burger in a foam container, and when it got to the point where the public was not happy about those being thrown along the roadside, they found a company in northern Massachusetts that would reprocess those. They were making picnic tables and benches out of them. They made those stops. If you go into a parking lot, you don't want to hit the wall. Those they're usually made out of concrete, but now they're making them out of chopped up plastic parts. So there is work going on, and to me it's pretty exciting that.
This stain is just in here because it's plastic?
Yeah.
I thought there was going to be a...
Oh, no, well, if you want to be a little more...
Give it to the NSA.
Oh, you know what? I probably have to change the battery. Oh, well, I can't show them.
Oh, there's a battery in there?
Yeah, it walks.
Oh.
Can you melt those plastics, or is it just... Yes, the mints is...
There are some toxic fumes. There are some toxic parts, like the different paints. Mm-hmm. When I was starting to work on this floor, I had to wear a mask because of the fumes from that paint. And also, it's a matter of if a company wants to spend the processing money to make it a three-step system instead of one. Right now, there aren't a lot of them who want to do that because it's very expensive. It's like the difference between the cost of a 3D printer, which is what, it's down to $2,000 now, mm-hmm. or a 3D frosting bakery printer.
I saw that one before, yeah, right?
For $100,000. So, you know, it's a matter of who's going to use the equipment for what. But I think there are folks around, especially high school students, who are excited to get in on something and do something. So Tom and I are going to try to get all the information.
I have a story to tell about plastics.
Great.
And kind of recycling them. So I was a hiker on the Appalachian Trail, and this man who happened to be a chain smoker and a through hiker, he was hardcore. He would collect plastics, put them in a can, and burn them, and then cook. It was so funny. There was this stove. I mean, talk about a toxic meal.
Some of them.
No, I mean, he would cook all. Yeah. You know, that was how he heated his food.
Well, I understand.
My God.
If you burn one of those cups,
yeah,
it's arsenic. coming into your face around the campfire.
He was quite a character, though. But, you know, he was a thru hiker. It was like his second or third time hiking the entire AT. So we had a lot of respect for this guy.
Even sure. He possibly wasn't a character before he started, but he was.
He made a big impression on us. You know, we were young, and he was a little bit older. It was funny, though.
Well, at least he wasn't one of those hikers that goes up Mount Everest and leaves everything that was heavy.
Yeah. You know, yeah. No, he was collecting trash along the way and burning it.
Well, which way are we moving to get rid of plastics? Because I mean, it doesn't seem like it's happening quick enough. You know.
I don't think there's.
I mean, you still go to a grocery store, you get a plastic bag.
Yeah. I don't think there's a strong move. You know, I mean, Joe Bryan will make us wooden spoons instead of plastic ones for our picnics.
In Washington, D.C., they've outlawed plastic bags, I think.
Okay.
Or they're moving towards that direction.
Yeah.
My sister told me.
Actually, that happened to me in Fleet Y the other day.
What happened?
No more plastic bags.
There's certain areas that are starting that. Yeah, Massachusetts, I think, is one of them.
They're outlawing it?
But you didn't bring your own bag.
In the grocery store.
You have to pay for the paper?
Yep.
You're kidding.
10 cents a bag, it was.
And they'll sell you.
Unless you have your own.
You can bring in your own.
Your own, yeah.
Of course, we didn't know that. So I kept saying to the kid, you know, put more stuff in that bag. It's all right.
So there is a move here and there.
Yeah.
But it seems we're really behind Europe. I think,
oh, I'm sure.
Yeah. Europe, I think they're more.
Part of it is the fact they have less territory to pile junk in. And so they got to it sooner than we did. You know, there are still ridiculous proposals like, let's buy a piece of the Grand Canyon, one of the side canyons, and make it a landfill.
You know what's odd is like Boston, as big as Boston is, my daughter lived there for a while. They did not recycle one thing. And when she came home, she just automatically threw.
Everything went into one garbage.
Yeah, everything. Newspapers, everything.
I think the cities like New York have a problem because the cost of removing it, where they're going to put it, they don't have like the storage space that we have in communities like this. So I think that's why Bloomberg did away with it, because it just was not making money. They were losing money. And he couldn't really justify economics.
Yeah, lack of spaces in other places like Europe. But you also have laziness.
Mm-hmm.
They caught a guy in Millington emptying his sewage truck because he saw an empty field in the middle of the night. Part of it is lack of concern, and we need more training. That's why getting involved with the schools is going to be helpful.
Going back to petroleum, you mentioned how Rockefeller realized that they were going to run out of whale oil, and the kerosene was a wave of the future. Now, automobiles weren't really on the horizon yet. I don't know whether he envisioned a combustion engine replacing the electric cars. Was a situation similar to what we're facing now, that there was a certain type of fuel, mostly wood, I guess, or maybe wood, and some kind of oil, they were running short and they really needed something? Or did this just sort of spur the development of cars because they had this abundant source of fuel? Which was first, the chicken or the egg?
I think people liked the fact that you could build a car that was not electric. And there was a fuel. And the fuel was rolling up out of the ground, at least in the Midwest. They had a dig for it, had a pump for it. But
if that hadn't come along, you think we'd be driving electric cars, or we would have been, or?
They were quite plentiful in the early 1900s, 1904, 1905. I think we would have, and now we get the Tesla company out of California who wants to take us back to that.
Yeah.
I would love to have some classic car kits here for our students and have them build a model that they send for, but I want it to be electric. And I'm going to talk to CLMP about putting a couple of charging stations out on the side of the wall. I've been after our custodians to change our pickup truck for years because you can buy a kit in upstate Massachusetts. There's a company that they started out with VW bugs and started converting those. So it's coming back. It's just a matter of who's got the new, Ford's got a new one, Chevy's got a new electric car. I just saw advertised on TV the other night. So it's not like they're not thinking about it. And it may be that this material that I passed around is not going to last forever. I mean, even before they started fracking, they thought we were going to run short. And of course, our government in Washington wants us to be independent of the rest of the world. We've been leaning on them for too long for the supplies. And of course, now so many other nations are using petroleum for fuel. So there's less of it from the Middle East. It's interesting to see where it's going to go.
What about heating, though? I mean, heating. If we lose fuel, I mean, if we have no more, everything would be electric?
Well, if you don't have to use it to power your vehicles, then there's more for heating.
I think 50% of our fuel consumption goes to vehicles.
Yeah.
So that would be a big chunk right there.
That would be a big chunk, yeah.
So if we, and some agencies are going electric. If you've seen any of those pictures of the huge earth movers out in the open pit mines in Utah and Nevada, they're electric. And they just bring them in at night and charge them. And the school buses in Atlanta, they're out in a shed, they park. And late in the afternoon, and it's got solar panels on the top of it, and they recharge them for the next day.
Wow.
So there are some great
It's a push-pull world in many ways. You know, think about in the 1950s when electricity was cheap, we were building homes with electric heat.
Yeah.
A great many of them. And then when electricity got expensive, then we moved to other things, and, you know, the whole concept of solar and everything else. It seems like today we are less nervous about running out of petroleum. Is it because of the fracking, or is it because
Well, right now there's a whole new source. There's two. There's one in Canada, and there's one in North Dakota, and they found a new technique to get at the stuff they can't just drill and get. Fracking is a vertical pipe, a vertical drill that curves at the bottom, and then goes horizontal through a layer of this stuff, and it follows the seam, and not only does it pull the oil that's easily freed, but it's full of nasty chemicals and water, and they blast it through the seam and rip the seam apart. It's also full of little tiny plastic BBs, so they crack it in upper and lower as well. So fracking is probably should be called cracking because they are ripping the rocks apart. But in some cases, they're down 20,000 feet. And they claim that they're below the water table, except for that one shot. So they're not going to hurt the water table. But all that material that they use, they suck back up, and they have to put it in a holding pond somewhere. First, it was they could put it in a truck and send it wherever they wanted. And now it's become, it was like nuclear waste. You have to get rid of it on your own property. You can't just ship it someplace, even though South Carolina was asking for it, because they could make money off it.
And fracking is more popular now because of the rise in the price of oil?
And also the fact that they've discovered a mother load, so to speak, of it that they didn't have the technology for before. If you get a chance to get a copy of it, this National Geographic from a year ago is all about fracking. And there's a great map in here that shows northwestern North Dakota. And there are 3,000 wells there already. And those are wells that are going down 20,000 feet, and then they're going horizontal for another 4,000. They're already there because they found so much available in that layer. It's also similar to the one not too far north in Canada, although there's another one in Alberta that's a shale. like one of those rocks, and they figure they can crush that and get oil out of it, or they can heat it and get oil out of it and put it in the pipeline. So they're finding new sources, and they have new technology. And so, unfortunately, the pressure's probably going to be off. The environment's going to get polluted more. That's part of the difficulties.
So besides solar, though, when you talk about electric things, what's firing the electric things? Isn't it oil, or...?
You mean to start them up? They have storage batteries. So the sunlight hits the panels, and in those panels there's a chemical connection that makes an electron spark, and the spark goes to the battery. Okay.
But there are other power sources for you, like right up the street here.
Yeah.
The water okay. driven turbines, yeah. and then there's the nuclear stuff that is yeah. creating.
So there are other sources besides.
Yeah. Did you see on TV the most expensive rental in the United States?
Yeah. Way ahead of Washington and New York City. And
yeah. It costs more to rent a room
$2,500 a month
in Williston, North Dakota than anywhere else because they don't have any. So they're building them. And they're having to stay in a tent until they get the hotel or the condo built. And it's just, there are 7,000 people in the town. Most of them were ranchers.
Building fast.
And now it's going to, population's going to triple. They're building dormitories. One of the biggest increases in population up there are the drivers, the big rig drivers who are either bringing in equipment or hauling this waste somewhere, wherever they're taking it. And there's, you know, one two-lane highway, east-west highway.
It's interesting because I made a comparison of Titusville, Pennsylvania. I mean, here's this little rural place, and they discover oil there, and it becomes like it's just a horrible place to be in, you know, besides the smell and all that business. And it's just, you know, people just putting up shacks and everything else. And that's what's happened to, is it Williston?
Williston, North Dakota. Williston, North Dakota. It's like the gold rush. It is a black and gold rush. And that's part of the difficulties. And
do you think it'll last?
No, they're going to run out. You know, eventually, that seam, like a gold seam, will be gone.
And when?
I don't know. They used to say 400 years, but that was now has been reduced about half.
Because I saw, you know how that sometimes you can go on the internet and the New York Times has these little stories. Well, in Belgium, they want to move an entire town so that they can continue with the seam. You know, this one of these mega machines that yep. gets the coal. Well, it's reached its capacity and it needs to keep going, but the old town is right there in the way. Mm. So what they want to do is move the whole medieval town so they can continue with
this. They've already done that in Wyoming.
Oh, really?
Move the
small
town.
They found
a coal seam that was only 10 feet below the surface, so they could strip mine it. So when they got to the town, they had a town meeting. We're building you a nice town,
a new town.
2 miles away.
Yeah, it was really sobering, like, you know, because probably, and it was a really interesting little article too, because it showed, it also explained that, I think this was in Belgium, I don't know, it was one of the northern European countries, but it also explained that at the same time, in that region, they're using more and more solar power than ever before, but they're also consuming more and more coal than the coal company is doing booming business. So it's sort of like this paradox of sort of this competing. I guess power in general is just everybody needs, but they need both. They need to continue with both.
And
it's
one
really
of the new
weird.
Technologies for coal is to turn it into petroleum. The chemists are working on that too.
Yeah, it was really amazing.
You own your own homes. You know you don't own your mineral rights. You know that a company can come in and start digging in your front yard.
It can or cannot?
It can. if they get a go-ahead from the state or the local company, they can excavate. And if you live in Salisbury, there's still a lot of iron under those places. Mineral rights are entire different legal ball of wax. And a mineral company can come in, I would guess an oil company could come in and put a drill in your front yard like they did at the...
Who owns the rights now?
Oklahoma.
Yeah, the Oklahoma's got an oil derrick right in front of the Capitol on the gas.
Who owns the rights now?
Whoever kept them or put them in escrow, I don't know. Mm. In particular. But it's the same. You get out west, it's even worse. You don't own the grazing rights of your land either. So they can run herds across your front yard and ruin your picnic.
So do you profit from what they get off your land?
Probably not, because it's not your land. You probably own this much of it.
But so who owns the grazing rights and the oil, the mineral rights? Is it a government thing? Or you
It's usually independent companies.
It started way back when at some point.
Yeah, you know, they signed the lease. The iron in Salisbury, I think, had a 99-year lease, and it started to run out at the beginning of World War II. That's when they started ripping up railroad tracks that they decided they didn't need anymore and re-smelting them.
That's what the credit mobile air scandal was about. It was oil drilling rights. And,
yeah.
That was out west during the 1920s. Mm. And they just went on people's property and drilled.
And if you weren't careful about what you bought out west, a railroad would buy it and run right through.
Well, isn't that where eminent domain comes into play as well? Yeah.
And I imagine the state has that pretty well tied up.
A federal government.
Yeah, it starts federally.
It's like the Indian land, too.
I was about to say that. Are they drilling on Indian land for shale or whatever?
Well, the good thing is the Indians are. The ones that have been sent away from North Carolina and South Carolina and Florida, shipped in what, the 1840s when Jackson was president, shipped out to this desolate place, which later became called Oklahoma. And then, lo and behold, they found coal and oil.
Well, the Connecticut tribes changed the philosophy. You know, you always wanted. Daughters of the American Revolution wanted everybody to be related to these historic figures, the Pilgrims and everything else, the first people that came over. Now, I want to be related to the Mohegan. because I got a piece of the pie.
Barbara took me to a conference once, and one of the speakers was Trudy Wright-Lamb from the Kent Preservation. She was just got to go, and I had her son Lance in class. And so we went and sat in front of the room, and I said, oh boy, you know, these folks know me, and I'm the kid's teacher. And she told me how bad I was on stage, pointing that I was one of those white Europeans who came over here and took stuff.
White male.
Yeah.
Funny, I don't remember any of that.
I thought my grandfather was a good guy. So
what's your prediction for the future of oil in the United States?
The U.S. is going to hang tough because we have so many needs. So if we run out of places specifically here, we're going to tap Mexico and we're going to tap Canada. There'll probably be a lot of talk about that's neater than going to the Middle East. Continental activity, but I think citizens have to say, I'd rather have my house heated than my truck driven, and so I put an electric motor in the truck. I don't know. It's all social.
Yeah, it's very social.
So it would have to be like a grassroots.
Well, you know, we get a lot of green people started the anti-sloppy pollution. And there'll probably be a group, in my estimate, that we'll try to come up with an alternate.
What was that battle recycling and all that came from?
I'm sorry, what?
Recycling of like the bottles and cans, and wasn't that from the people? Didn't that?
Yeah, I remember bringing our high school kids to Hartford when the state didn't want to pass the bottle bill. And our kids tried to stand up and speak, and most of them were told they weren't 21 yet and they can't use the microphone, that kind of crap. And so we... But it did get passed, and it got passed in Oregon and Vermont. I think of those two right away as being forerunners of recycling, getting, you know, you pay an extra nickel for your bottle in the six pack, and you get it back if you want to go to that trouble. Mm-hmm. The landfills have trouble, the recycling centers have trouble, because each material is usually paid to them by weight. So if you got a truck of copper, you're going to make a lot more money than if you have a truck of glass bottles, and you have to separate them by color to get the money. But what's worse is this stuff doesn't weigh enough. You fill up a truck full of empty bottles of plastic, and they don't get anywhere near the amount of money they can earn from the other materials.
They have to crush them before they put them on the truck, then.
Yeah, but still, if they're so light, yeah. Is that the snowstorm?
Yeah.
So
very big snow.
The whole thing is tied into weight. Now there's value. Copper and lead are certainly worth more than
that. So we need to educate.
It all comes down to
education.
Start
so, I mean,
early. Actually, you know, I think there is an evolution of education.
Yeah.
I mean, kids are much more aware of this than we ever were.
Yeah.
You know? And,
but we still have to continue.
I think it circles itself, and it also, there is an economic motivation to all this. Mm-hmm. You know, if I can come up with being able to make oil out of dirt, I got a lot of dirt in my yard.
Yeah.
That,
you don't know it.
Look at what they make out of sand. Glass. Glass is just melted sand. Mm-hmm. All you have to do is go to the beach with your shovel. Mm-hmm. Or have a beachfront property.
So I was curious what you read about John D. Rockwell, what impression you come up with as far as a businessman, an energy developer. Was he?
I thought he had a lousy personality.
Yeah,
he was antisocial. He was rude, you know, because he was smarter than a lot of people in his business meetings. Mm-hmm. He would look at his shoes and wouldn't pay attention. But he was so wise in the nature of how to make money off of objects, whether it was wheat or whether it was kerosene. Mm-hmm. And he could sell, of course his father helped sell, he could sell. That particular book, which is the only one I read about him, was favorable. I understand there were two others written by authors who hated him because he screwed their grandfathers out of territory or something.
It's a really interesting concept, because he became so rich that at some point in his life, money didn't matter anymore. But he kept accumulating it, and then he decided to give it away. Mm-hmm. He's very religious. He didn't drink. He wasn't a womanizer. They've given millions upon billions of dollars away as well. But he also invested in things that would regenerate. Mm-hmm. The big nut.
Yeah. Build another refinery because he had the money.
He's a guy that you probably want to deposit his money in your bank.
Absolutely. No questions asked.
Very successful. Nobody argued that.
Was it he or his son who was the big philanthropist? It was the first one, right? University of Chicago and Rockefeller University and all those philanthropic things.
He was philanthropic, but his son was more so.
Well, his son ran the foundation
for the foundation
for the distribution.
Mm-hmm.
but he certainly was money earned from the oil business.
And his dad's just gotten away, you know, from time to time, selling oil. I'd like to finish with a couple of quick personal things. If you get a chance, I want to go to Titusville. Mm-hmm. I'll go down to Danbury and get on Route 6 and just go until you get out here to Oil City and or Titusville. It's a nice drive. It's not a fast drive, but you can go to the Green Canyon of Pennsylvania, which is on the way. You can go to Williamsport, where the Little League is played, the World Series. You can go see Punxsutawney Phil if it's the right season. And they're all along that road. So it's a lot of fun if you have some time. And then when you get to Titusville, you can go to Colonel Drake's replica of the first well in the 1850s, where he decided to dig for the stuff instead of waiting for it to flow up to the surface. A nice museum. It's well done. And you can walk around the grounds. Be careful that you don't step in the stream because the oil is still flowing through it.
So you can actually see a place where there's oil?
Yes.
You saw that?
I walked nearby. One of our students stepped in, not on purpose. But and it's pretty crude. It's pretty thick.
Is it like this?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And in many cases, it's there's a stream and there's regular water on top of it, but doesn't take you long to smell the sulfur and to see it. It's really well done. And the model they made of the original wooden framed 1.5-story drilling rig is well done. And that's a lot of fun to go visit. I wanted to talk a little bit about California. I spent some time in the Central Valley, which is chock full of thousands of oil derricks and pumps and natural gas as well. If you know about the Central Valley of California, there's two parts to it. The northern part is the Sacramento Valley, and the southern part is the San Joaquin Valley. That's before you get to the farms. Mm-hmm. And this happens to have under it a great pool of natural gas and petroleum. And so they've been drilling there for a long time. I was at Berkeley one summer for a geology class, and one of our professors took us out to a cute little town out here called Coalinga, C-O-A-L-I-N-G-A, which stands for Coaling Station Number 8. The trains used to get the coal there. It was the first one. And when we get out of the bus, he said, go over along the cliff face, you're going to find some tremendous marine fossil shells because this was under the ocean once upon a time. And this is a good collecting spot. But before you go, let me give you these masks. Because if you raise up too much dust, you don't want it going into your lungs because it's full of the HANTA virus.
Full of the what?
HANTA virus, the one that killed the hikers out in Four Corners, Colorado.
I've never heard about that.
It's a South American virus that somehow got here, and it's in the feces of mice and bats.
Oh, wow.
So if you're stirring up the dirt, be careful when you're trying
did
to process.
Did it kill the hikers? How did it kill the hikers? All of a sudden?
Went into their lungs and they got a non-recoverable case of what was like the flu.
Was it the Navajo too?
Yes.
Yeah, that was the first one about, 10, 12 years ago, I think.
Yeah.
But it was in the adobe houses, and in this case, I think it was actually a cabin or something where they had spent the night, I think.
Really
which
sad.
Comes first, the petroleum? I go down. Do I go through the natural gas first or the petroleum?
They're together.
They are together.
The gas is bubbling through the petroleum.
You just look for the label.
So they're not separate, but they can be processed separately. For a long time, they used to let the gas come up to the surface of the oil derrick and burn it off. They didn't have any use for it in the early 1900s, and they made nice little torches in the fields.
That was natural gas burning off?
Yeah. And they still do that in some of the refineries.
Oh, you see it in the Jersey refineries all the time. They're burning off the impurities.
Yeah. So, probably someday those impurities will be useful, mm-hmm. and somebody will figure that out. But right now, they're excess. So the man gave us the masks, and he gave us our shovels, and he said, one other thing, if you hear the ground rumble, don't get nervous, but we're 20 feet away from the San Andreas Fault, which is probably why some of the oil moved, and they were able to get to it fairly easily as a drill. So there were 30 of us in a bus, and we were there for 2 days. We didn't go out the second day. We just sat at breakfast and we stayed. We had breakfast for about 5 hours. We told the professor we weren't going to collect any. It was for his collection anyway. So we decided we wouldn't go out again. So it's not, in some cases, it's not easy territory to work. I think a worse place would probably be out in the Gulf on one of those rigs. I mean, there are. It's so valuable a commodity, but it's so dangerous in some places to process it or live near it. It's still explodable. The latest explosion in New York City.
Today.
And Dave and I were talking earlier about the problem with the Corvair gas tanks. You know, they were full of gasoline, and if you bump somebody, they blow up.
Well, they are unsafe at any speed.
And so it's a dangerous substance as well as helpful. It's got to be tightly controlled, and all kinds of materials. So you probably, this is a shorter drive for you. And that one. What I would suggest going to both when you get a chance. You got a vacation coming up. I've also been here to Modesto and also Midlands, George Bush territory, George W. Bush. That's where he made a lot of his money. Odessa has all kinds of oil drilling systems and refineries. Did you watch the TV show from the movie Friday Night Lights? Mm-hmm. It was a pretty good movie that they turned into a not very good TV show. The name of the high school is the Permian High School, P-E-R-M-I-A-N, and the Permian White Rim Sandstone is a cliff out there that's black because it's full of oil. It's another source. There are a whole series of those in West Texas in this area, and of course, not too far away from the state house in Oklahoma. So, places to visit when you get the urge.
Let's get a field trip going. What do you say, guys?
Okay, let's drive.
Load up the bus.
That's right. You're the driver. We have.
That's amazing. Sure.
I give anybody any questions. I tried to go through 3 hours in 1 hour.
It was a perfect 3 hours, as far as I'm concerned. Perfect.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, good job.